So hopefully you received a little bulletin, and it's that time of the week, or I guess month, where we attach the monthly calendar with it. So that's just for you, so you have information about all that's happening in our church family. So look that over, and if you're new with us, we just are especially glad that you're here. Connection card is there, and you guys, if you're one of our regulars, you know about that, but we just want to use that as a way to really connect. If you're new with us, we just love to just get a little bit of information so we can stay in touch with you, answer any questions you have. So use those connection cards. Prayer requests, you notice on the back side of the connection card is a place where you can write your prayer request. We're really serious about praying. And so as you turn in prayer requests, we are praying on Sunday nights and throughout the week for those things as well. Those connection cards and your offering can be placed in the boxes as you leave at the exits. Let's just highlight a few things, if we could, on announcements before we move ahead. Men, today's a great day to sign up for the retreat. It's coming out May 5th through the 7th. That's not very far away. I know it seems like a long time, and men were really kind of bad about procrastinating about these sort of things. So don't expect your wife to sign you up. You can do that yourself. Go out in the foyer and talk with Dustin and Dan, and you can sign up right there. You can go to our website. Just make it happen. It's going to be a great retreat down at Rockaway Beach. Jim Velez will be with us, who's just a great communicator, and it's just going to be a good time. Don't miss it. I always look forward to that weekend. Isaac already mentioned that Resurrection Sunday is coming up, and we have two services on that day, 9 and 11. We always have a full house, most churches do, but be prayerful that as new people come, that they're impacted with the message of Jesus, right? And don't just do a church thing, but maybe they could actually experience a Jesus thing on that day. So be in prayer about that particular Sunday. For those that love the morning, some of you do that. 6 o'clock in the morning is a good group of us that gather over in the stadium there in Estacada, and we just worship the Lord together and watch the sunrise, kind of. Sometimes you can see it when it comes up. Sometimes it's just cloudy, but we have a great time. That's for all the churches in the area, so it's good to get together with other believers at that setting. So coming up on the 9th, we have this vision meeting. Let's talk about that for just a little bit. Everybody's invited to a potluck. Bring something to eat. It works better that way, all right? So bring some food, a main dish, a salad, or a dessert. And we're gathering in the fireside room right after our gathering. We'll all just enjoy being together. And then we're going to come back in here. Covenant members have a couple issues to vote on. But then all of us together are just going to talk about next steps in our church family. We're excited about some opportunities and some challenges, and some next steps. So we just want to get everybody on the same page and look forward to what God is doing. And not just what God is doing, but what He wants to continue to do. We just don't want to be at a place where we're kind of settled with the place God has us. But Lord, where do You want to take us next? And so I'm going to look at that. So excited for all of you to be present for that. So our Tibetan outreach team right now, they are in India. We've been praying for them. We're going to end our service today with a time of prayer for them. That's just a picture of us at Portland Airport, just as they sent out. And I know many of you have been praying. So they're in India. They're off and going. They're tired because you always start the trip that way. It's just kind of grueling to get there. So keep praying for the connections. Keep praying that they would have God's eyes to see all the opportunities. And for those that are new, we have a lot of new first-timers on this trip, that they just be able to step into the opportunities and not be kind of overwhelmed with just the experience of being in India. We're excited about what God is doing, certainly privileged to be a part of what God is doing around the world. So be in prayer for them, and we'll wrap up our time together today praying for them. Hey, Mark and Val are right down here. I hear you guys are covenant members now. Yeah, we did accept, yeah. So if you don't know Mark and Val, they're down here, and we're excited for you guys to be a part of the church family, what God is doing here. So want to make sure everybody's aware of that. All right. Hey, that's a good reminder. You can silence your cell phones even as we get started. That was almost like a setup, wasn't it? Yeah, we had somebody do that. How many of you have ever snorkeled, like in Hawaii? It's amazing, isn't it? So it's been a few years ago. We had one of those kind of neat adventures to be over in Hawaii and be able to snorkel. And I experienced, any of you that have snorkeled experience it, it's just phenomenal what you see as soon as you stick your face down in the water. It's just everything. It's like the whole ocean is alive, and you can see these fish and these creatures and these turtles and all this amazing stuff, and you just kind of get off exploring, and all of a sudden, yeah, it's like you're just in this next, this new world. I've felt like that, kind of like a snorkeling experience, and you actually might feel like that over the next weeks as we jump into Hebrews chapter 11. Because Hebrews chapter 11, let's call it the ocean of faith. And as we get into it, it's like there's so much there, and it's intriguing, and it's amazing, and it's beautiful, and it's overwhelming. It's like you can never take it all in, and actually you can't. But we're going to jump in today, and some of you may wander off snorkeling and seeing some other things, but hopefully we all kind of surface at the end. If we don't... have a good adventure as we move ahead. But we need to have a little bit of a warning as we get into Hebrews chapter 11. We make an error if we take this chapter and kind of separate it out as this unique word on faith, apart from already everything that's been said about faith. So we need to make sure we understand that where we're moving now in our study of Hebrews is just a continuation of the repeated and continuing theme that's been in the book of Hebrews. It's not now something different. And the danger is if we don't understand the context, we make faith something that the Bible doesn't even speak of. We make faith like this bottle, this magic bottle. If you just rub it, you can get God to do anything you want Him to do. That's not what this chapter is about. This chapter is not trying to get God to do what you want for Him. It's not a ticket to have all that you want in life. And sometimes you see faith talked about in those terms, like if you just have faith, then you can just make anything happen. That's not seen in the book of Hebrews. And you have to twist Scripture to make it say those sort of things. So it's important, again, that we understand the context. So can we talk about that for just a moment? What leads us into this chapter of faith, Hebrews chapter 11? Remember, last week we looked at the author of Hebrews took this amazing statement from the book of Habakkuk about the righteous one living by faith. But it was very specific, as we talked about at the time, it's about he takes that statement from Habakkuk in the Old Testament, brings it into the context. So this is about faith in Jesus and seeing this faith in Jesus continue and continue to grow. It's not about faith in faith or even faith in providence, but it's very specific, not about their faith in themselves, but faith in Jesus Christ. And again, remember these followers of Jesus were having a really hard time, and they were struggling with keeping the faith. And maybe we just go back to what we believed before, because following Jesus is really hard. Have you ever experienced that? It is really hard at times. But live by faith. And then right before we get into chapter 11, right at the end of chapter 10, there's this verse that says, "But we are not of those who shrink back to destruction, but of those who have" what? "Faith to the preserving of the soul." What is this faith that is the preserving of the soul? Again, in the context of Hebrews, this is all about Jesus, right? It's this faith in Jesus that holds us and sustains us and preserves us. It's a confident assurance in what Jesus has done. It's not about my strength or about their strength. It's about the power of Jesus. It's not about my wisdom or being able to figure anything out. It's about the wisdom found specifically in Jesus Christ. So notice then, if we take this verse here and move right into Hebrews chapter 11 without that pause that we often put at the beginning of Hebrews chapter 11, it looks like this. But we are not of those who shrink back to destruction, but of those who have faith to preserving of the soul. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. And for by it, by faith, the men of old gained approval. That word now at the beginning of verse 1 of chapter 11 could be translated and. It's like, and now this is what that faith in Jesus is really all about. It's not something different that he's talking about. It's just the continuing of this emphasis of a profound and deep following after Jesus. Now, one more thought, just by way of review. We talked about faith a little bit last year, or last week, leading up to this week. And we talked about that the two critical aspects of faith are the object of the faith and the action of the faith. It's not about the amount of faith or the size of faith, but the object of faith. And again, here's the test. The object of faith in the book of Hebrews is who? It's Jesus, right? That's what he's been emphasizing. Your faith needs to be in Jesus. And then he says, now the actions of that faith in Jesus continue on. It's not just this one time I believed at one moment, but now it continues. And now we see faith continue into Hebrews chapter 11. So we're going to read our text together. Actually, Caroline's going to read it for us. Would you all stand together with me? It'll go up on the screen. She's going to read it for us. This is Hebrews chapter 11, starting in verse 10, chapter 10, verse 39, moving into 11. Follow as Caroline reads.
But we are not of those who shrink back to destruction, but of those who have faith to the preserving of the soul. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the men of old gained approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible. By faith Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained the testimony that he was righteous. God testifying about his gifts, and through faith, though he is dead, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he would not see death, and he was not found because God took him up. For he obtained the witness that before his being taken up, he was pleasing to God. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him.
Those are great words, amen. Father God, I pray that today that the Holy Spirit would come and be our teacher today. Lord, give us a focus to be able to see how this faith needs to be alive in each one of us, Lord, for where you have us right now. So make it personal, please. Make it powerful. Make it very practical, your truth to us. Amen. All right, you can be seated. So as we kind of snorkel around, so to say, in this text, we could go all kinds of different directions. We're just going to grab the truth here with six statements. Again, if you wander off, hope you come back. If not, we're all going to surface at the end and we'll wrap it up. Here's the first statement. Faith is about revelation, not what is physically seen. It's about revelation, not about what is physically seen. So we see that in verse 1. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Now, that verse to us looks, it's kind of an interesting verse, but you need to understand that what the author is doing there, he's connecting with his Hebrew audience, because that's an example in that verse of what is called Hebrew parallelism, which is simply this. You make a statement, and then you make another statement, and those statements together are either clarifying the truth or they're making a contrast that helps us understand the truth. So it's this statement that they got very well. I mean, they understood what he was doing here. So we see two statements. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for. Faith is the conviction of things not seen. And so now those are parallel, and in that it's clarifying this truth. He's confirming the point by the way he's saying that. Faith is assurance. Faith is conviction. Faith is about things that are hoped for or expected. It's not about the things that we necessarily see. So all that to say, this faith that we talk about in following after Jesus that continues in our lives is built on something other than the visual, the what we see with our eye. It's based on something certain, but not on that which we often think of as certain. Now, sometimes you've heard that phrase, a leap of faith, which kind of implies it's a step into something that it's kind of vague and muddy, and you don't know really what's going on. It's kind of like the little boy that came back from church and his father asked him, so what did you study today? He says, well, we learned about faith. Father says, well, what is this faith that you learned about? And the little boy says, that's when you believe in something that you know isn't true. Yeah, it's that leap of faith, right? It's not true at all, but we're just going to put our faith in it. That's not what this is talking about. Because that's not faith. What's that called? That's just foolishness, right? It's foolishness. Faith is not foolish, but here's the deal. Sometimes it looks foolish because it's not about what is seen visibly. Now, it's of course natural and even expected that we as physical beings would depend much on things that we can see and taste and smell, hear. Yet in the goodness of God, in the goodness of God, He wants to wean us off our singular dependence on those things. Those things are necessary. The physical is necessary. But He's saying, move with me into things that are just as certain, just as real, but you just can't see them in the physical. Now, in His goodness, He tries to wean us off the physical because sometimes we get far too dependent on it. And again, another reason in His goodness He weans us off the physical is because, frankly, the physical is sometimes really disappointing, isn't it? And frankly, very frustrating. And we feel confined by it at times. The Apostle Paul captures both, I think, the frustration and this weaning process and this statement where he writes to the Corinthian church. He says, we do not lose heart, but though our outer man is decaying, that's the physical, yet our inner man is being renewed day by day. He says, momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond comparison, while we look not at the things which are seen, but what? You see that? But the things that are not seen. That's almost a crazy statement. We don't look at the things that you can see. We look at the things you can't see. But he says, in doing that, there's this eternal weight of glory as we're weaned off all these physical things that we're so dependent on. You see, the physical is frustrating. It's always changing. It's even decaying. But there's something that's spiritual, that's eternal, that's substantial, that is even lasting. something much more weighty, something much more eternal. And all of us, I think, even right now are in this weaning process, and that's hard. We like our attachment to those things that are physical. But Jesus is saying, follow me into something that's even more real than that. So again, faith is about what is revealed even spiritually, not about what is seen physically. But it has a foundation. Again, I just take you to those two words. It's assurance and it's conviction. It's built on something solid. It's built on the revelation of God. And aren't you glad that God is a God who reveals? Amen. He has revealed himself in many different ways, but not always in the physical. Sometimes in the physical, but more so in the spiritual realm. Now, I want to remind you, one of the struggles these early believers were having is they couldn't see this Jesus, and actually they'd never seen this Jesus, but they could see the temple, and they could see the priests, and they could put their hands on the sacrifices. And so there's this alluring to go back to what was physical, and the writer's saying, no, there's something unseen. This Jesus, you can't see him. He's real. Your faith needs to remain there. Now, it's different for us. We don't have the temple and the priests and all that sort of thing. But still, here's the challenge for us. Will we fix our eyes on Jesus, who you can't see, to lead you through all these challenges of life and continue to live by faith? That's our challenge. That's the spiritual growth that we're all in, this process. To live by faith, not by sight. Here's another comment the Apostle Paul makes about this. Therefore, always be of good courage, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. So I think our point was that we walk by faith, not by sight. And it's interesting, as I'm looking at my notes, we have faith not because our physical world is just like we like it. And I'm sure Cindy's thinking that right now. This is what I expect to have happen right now. And yet there's something going on, even in the midst of things like this, that's very, very real, very, very certain that we put our trust in. You might be familiar with the old hymn, "It Is Well With My Soul." Some powerful words in there about faith in the life of a man that went through some very difficult things. Horatio Spafford, he said this. This is, I think, the last verse. "Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight, and the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, and the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend, even so it is well with my soul." Click that next slide. I think we have those words up there. Someday, faith will be sight because we'll see Jesus face to face. That's not now, is it? And so now it's about faith. And that's what God is all growing us more and more into. So faith is not about what we see, it's about what God has revealed, particularly and even specifically in the person and work of Jesus. Second point, faith has always been God's standard operating procedure. So the second verse there in Hebrews says, "For by it," what's the it? It's faith, "the men of old gained approval." So it's an error to think that this faith thing is now something new, that all of the Old Testament was different and now we have Jesus and now we have a life of faith. It's always been that way. Faith has always been God's standard operating procedure. It's how he's always worked with people. Some mistakenly think that in the Old Testament, God says, just do all these things. You don't need faith. Just be obedient, and it'll all be okay. And that's not it at all. If that's the case, then this whole chapter doesn't make any sense, because all of these heroes of faith were either before the law or right in the middle of the law, and yet it was always not by the law. It was always by what? It was by faith. That's how the men of old and the women of old found their relationship with God to be real. We might say that in the Old Testament, faith was looking forward to the coming of this Jesus. And now we look back at the coming of this Jesus, anticipate His coming again, but it's always by faith. It's interesting that in this chapter, well, in a moment we're going to see that it refers to creation. It doesn't refer to Adam and Eve. You ever wonder why Adam and Eve, part of creation, are not part of this chapter? Well, if you think about it, in a couple of reasons, is because, first of all, their life initially wasn't about faith, it was about sight, right? They had this amazing experience of being there with God. And that amazing phrase in the book of Genesis was that God would come and in the cool of the day and they would be together. It wasn't about faith for them. God blessed them in amazing ways. But even with all of that, when they sinned, what was it really about? We sometimes think, well, they sinned just because they disobeyed the command. Now think about this. It was sin because they chose not to have faith in what God said. God said something. And they struggled with, I don't know if we can trust that. I don't know if we can believe that. I don't know if we can have faith in that. So in essence, when we go all the way back to the garden, the big failure was a failure of faith. Even in this environment where God had blessed them with His very presence. Huge consequence to that lack of faith that we all deal with even today. So as we kind of alluded to creation there, we're going to make one more point. We'll pick this up next week. Faith, because it goes all the way back to creation, is a very foundational issue. Verse 3 says, by faith we understand the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible. So here we again see this issue of faith going all the back to creation. Here's what we believe happened by faith when God brought it all into being. He says He did it by the word of God. That word is not the word logos that we often see in the New Testament. It's another word, rhema, which means God's declarative, purposeful, planned word to accomplish something. He spoke it into existence. What did He speak into existence, or what did He prepare by His speaking? The worlds, and that's an amazing word. It means not just what was physical, but even the time frame that everything exists in. He made it. He spoke it into existence at one time. So it's interesting in this hall of faith that ultimately we're going to see refers to a people that lived by faith. He's saying you need to understand it goes all the way back to not necessarily what people do, but what I've done in accepting that by faith. So I'm going to snorkel around here in this area of creation. And again, this is an area where you could go all kinds of different directions. Track with me here for just a moment. It's interesting how we in our culture today approach this issue of creation. How did things begin? Here's what many of us do. We look for evidence. We look for scientific evidence to prove what God said that He did. Let me say that again. Many of us are looking for scientific evidence to prove the what God said that he really, that's what he really did. Does that seem backwards a little bit to you? Maybe you missed that. We look for scientific proof, scientific evidence to prove God's word. Does that seem backwards to anybody? Are you seeing where I'm going with this? And again, we could wander around this a lot. That just seems backwards to me. Do we really need proof so that we can accept what God has clearly said? In other words, here's what God said. And you can read it in Genesis. It says, I spoke, and everything that is, the time frame, the worlds, the universe, came into existence out of nothing. I did that by my word, by my power. Do we need proof of that? Can we prove that? Now, if science says something different, here's what I would say. I would say science has some catching up to do to what God says. I would say there's some more information that science has yet to discover. Now, what I'm not saying is that somehow science and faith are in conflict. I don't think they are. The problem is science is still in process. What is science? The word science comes from the Latin word which means to know. Science is about knowing things and learning things and discovering things. Has any field of science exhausted all there is to know about that area? No. There's so much more to learn. There's so much more to discover. We're going to keep discovering what God has said is true. And sometimes things that science said was true were frankly way off. And it caught up and it says, yeah, we didn't see that quite right. We didn't think about that right. We didn't know everything we needed to know. Medical science thought at one time that sickness, at least some sickness, was due to too much blood in your system. So they put leeches on you to draw off some of the blood. I'm glad science caught up, aren't you? I'm glad science caught up with that. I actually understand they still use leeches for some things, but it's not because there's too much blood in us. Science progressed. And it will continue to progress. And here's what will happen in the end. Science will be validated by God's word, not the other way around. That's how it has to end, because science is God's. He made everything. He knows everything. And we're all here in this world trying to understand everything that God is doing and has done and has put together. So before we move on, or maybe end, what time is it? I've kind of lost track here. Yeah, we need to bring it to an end. To those that would say this, you know, I have faith in Jesus, but I just can't buy what the Bible says about creation. I want to remind you of this. This is what the Bible says about creation. He says this Jesus, the Bible says this Jesus that you believe in is the creator. Look at all these verses. Hebrews 1, where we started. Through whom all things were, through whom also he made the world. That's talking about this Jesus that you believe in. Colossians 1, for by him, that's Jesus, all things were created. In the book of John, all things came into being through him. Who's the him? It's this Jesus that we believe in. So we get ourselves in a little bit of a conflict when we say that, well, I believe in this Jesus, but this whole creation thing that God did it all, it's like, that's tough for me. You're in a bit of a conflict because God's word says not only did he do it all, he did it through this Jesus. in the very beginning, this one that has always been. So maybe kind of an odd place to stop, but that's okay, right? We'll trust that the Lord is working even providentially in this. We're going to pick it up right there with three more points from those verses. We're going to invite the worship team to come back up. Lindsay, wonderful song that you picked. This song that they're going to lead us in, I think it's called Oceans, which I think fits well with this kind of snorkeling idea, right? Okay, we're jumping into the ocean. And I just want you to notice what it's saying, that the Lord is always calling us out to take steps of faith, to live by faith, to act in faith. So this faith in Jesus is not just this one-time thing. It's continuing, right? It's growing. So we'll trust the Lord, even in the midst of kind of a broken-up service, that He is working. Let's pray together as we worship. Father God, we thank You for just the way You're working, and we'll keep praying for Cindy right now, that You'll just be doing a good work in her and through this situation. Lord, thank You that You're always stretching us. You're always telling us that You're in control, even when it seems like, that was a bit odd. So Lord, stretch us and grow us, and even as we sing this song, move us. Move us, Lord, closer to You. Amen.